Welcome to the 33rd meeting of 2022 of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. We've received apologies today from Jeremy Balfour, MSP, and before we move to the first item on the agenda, I'd like to remind everyone present to switch their mobile phones to silent. The first item of business is to decide whether to take items 5 and 6 in private. Is the committee content to take these items in private?
Yep.
Moving to agenda item number 2, we are taking evidence on the retained EU law revocation and reform bill. First of all, can I welcome Sir Jonathan Jones, Senior Consultant at Linklaters, LLP, and Dr Adam Tucker, who is a consultant, sorry, constitutional lawyer at the University of Liverpool, who are both joining us today virtually. And also Maura Gross, KC, member of the Faculty of Advocates, who is joining us in person. Can I welcome you all to the meeting today? First of all, can I remind attendees, first of all, to Maura Gross, not to worry about turning on the microphone, because that will happen automatically. And if you would like to come in on a question, please raise your hand. And in relation to Sir Jonathan and Dr Tucker online, please raise your hand or enter R in the Blue Jeans chat function. We'll now move to questions from the committee. So first of all, I'm going to open up today. So first of all, what in your view on the scope So the powers we have in front of us in terms of this rule bill, what is your view of the scope of the powers to preserve rule?
Is that directed at...
all three. Do you want to start, Warwick?
Well, I'm certainly happy to start, thank you.
Okay.
Yes, I should say at the outset that I'm here on behalf of the Faculty of Advocates. I'm aware that at least one of my colleagues has already given evidence on this bill to the lead committee, and so what I say about delegated powers should be seen in the context of what's already been said and what's been submitted in writing to that committee. And it's an unusual bill, of course, because on one view it's all about delegated powers, and so perhaps this committee has a slightly different role to the role that it would normally have, but you're all already fully aware of that. To come to your question, extremely broad. I mean, it's a bill that can't really be compared with other primary legislation. There isn't anything that is quite like this in that the whole purpose of this is to give government the power to introduce legislation which is extremely wide ranging. Will modify the law, modifies, putting it very tamely, but in across a whole range of areas, and is going to have to do so if law is to be retained and is to escape the sunset provisions at some speed. And these are things which have obviously caused concern to the lead committee here and to many others elsewhere, but in a word, broad.
Okay, thank you. And any of the witnesses online would like to come in? Sir Jonathan?
Yes, well, I agree with what's just been said. It's an extraordinary bill. It is indeed unlike any other before. And on the specific question of the powers, the truth is one can't know what the effect of this bill will be, what the law will be by, say, the end of 2023, without knowing how the powers will be exercised. The whole effect of the bill is dependent on the exercise of the powers, save only this, that if none of the powers are exercised, then virtually all retained EU law will fall away. And that of itself is a pretty extraordinary proposition that, in the absence of something positive happening, ministers deciding positively to retain or amend existing retained EU law, that whole body of law would drop away automatically. So the combination of those things, as to say the automatic expiry, the automatic sunsetting, coupled with this very wide set of powers to retain things, change things, replace things, produces a huge amount of uncertainty as to what the law will be, because we simply don't know at the moment which of those powers will be exercised and in which ways and in relation to which bits of retained EU law.
Thank you. And Dr. Tucker.
Yeah, so I'd start by agreeing with both of what Morag and Jonathan just said. So Morag drew attention to the breadth of the powers, and Jonathan. So Jonathan drew attention to the incredible uncertainty that they introduce. I just add two things. One flows directly, I think, from what Sir Jonathan just said. The nature of the cliff edge is that the powers are going to have to be exercised. So even though we're describing them as powers, there's almost going to be an obligation on governments and legislatures to exercise those powers. So the creation of these powers with a cliff edge on the other side of them actually imposes quite a remarkable legislative burden, which is worth noting. And the second thing I'll say is about where that legislative burden will fall. Now, because the bill allocates those powers to the UK government, to the devolved governments, and to those governments working in cooperation, part of the uncertainty is about how the division of labour is going to unfold in the exercise of those powers. But I would say that it's an absolute certainty that a significant amount of that burden will fall on the institutions of devolved government. So that's all I'd add to Morag's point about breadth and to Sir Jonathan's point about uncertainty.
Okay, no, thank you for that. So, I mean, the bill, certainly already touched upon, the bill does set the automatic date by which rule will be removed from the statute book, and also Dr. Tucker just spoke about the cliff edge. So what is your understanding of the number of pieces of legislation potentially affected? And do you have any further comment to make on this? Now, we have heard, I know the committee has heard various figures banded about. Is it 2,400, then potentially another 1,400, then potentially others. And we've also picked up a 5,000 figure was used at one point. So do you have any clarity on or any indication as to how many pieces of legislation actually will be included in this? Morag?
I can't add to the information that you already have. I don't work within government, and so I have no other access to that sort of information that you don't already have. I'm already also aware of the figures that that you've given. I would say, in addition to that, and this picks up the point just made by Dr. Tucker a moment ago about where the burden falls, the other difficulty, and it's not just looking at the global figures, but it's understanding where the devolved administrations, the devolved parliaments will have competence to look at those, and what proportion of the, whether it's 2,400 or 1,400 or 5,000 or however many it is, what proportion of those will fall within devolved competence. And there isn't necessarily, well, there isn't a clear dividing line that allows a clear and absolute distinction between those. But to answer your primary question, I can't assist with any further accurate clarification on the numbers.
Well, thank you. Dr. Tucker?
Yeah, I would say the reality is that the precise number is unknown because of the way the bill is structured. Because it picks out a category rather than specifying the number, the precise number is unknown. I'd also agree with the scale of the numbers that you just said. So it's plainly in the thousands, even if we can't be more precise. And I'd also stress the significance of that number is that the reality is that every single one of those has to be engaged with. That's why the number matters. But there's uncertainty, it's somewhere in the thousands, and every single one has to be engaged with in some way for regulation to persist in whatever it covers.
Okay, thank you. Sir Jonathan.
Well, I'm afraid I've got no more inside information either. So, I mean, I agree that the number, all we've got is the figures that the government gives. We also hear stories of new laws being discovered, which is a bit unnerving. I mean, there's a question in any event as to what is a piece of a law and how these laws are counted. So does a whole set of regulations count as one law or as many? I don't know the answer to that. I think this just underlines the point about uncertainty that I made before, and the risk that, as Dr. Tucker has said, if particular bits of legislation are missed and therefore not engaged with. So if no conscious decision is made about a particular law simply because it hasn't been spotted, it's dropped off the list, then the consequence will be that it falls away over the edge of the cliff by accident. So that's one of the other risks and uncertainties with this, because we don't have a certain number or we don't know the precise universe of laws that's affected. There must be a risk that some will be missed altogether with that consequence.
Thank you. The next question is probably more for Dr. Tucker, with some of the comments he's already indicated, but certainly if the other two witnesses would like to come in, please do so. So could you give us your reflections on the extent to which Parliament, as opposed to ministers, will actually be able to influence what this statute book will look like as a result of this bill?
Okay, so that's a topic that's one of my research interests, which is to do with the scrutiny of delegated legislation, which of course is a primary interest of this committee as well. The reality is that under existing practice, Parliament, and I'll talk about the Westminster Parliament to start with, and you'll be more familiar than me with how well these comments transfer to the Scottish context, but I think there's similarities. The reality is that Parliament will have minimal influence over that question, that the nature and the practices of scrutiny of delegated legislation in the UK are such that once the power is delegated, especially in the context we are now, which is in anticipation, it's best to anticipate that Parliament will have minimal levels of impact over how that power is ultimately used. And one thing I always say in conversations like this and in my written work is I always advocate changing that situation, but that's not realistic at the moment. And one way I often advocate changing it is by saying there should be a move towards scrutiny of the merits of these instruments. Because one thing, and this committee, you're familiar with this, it's in your terms of reference, I think, is there's a distinction between technical and legal scrutiny and substantive or merit scrutiny. And my advocacy for a shift towards merit scrutiny is always resisted for reasons I understand. But it's worth stressing that to the extent that Parliament will have an impact, the kind of scrutiny that Parliament will do under current practices will be limited to technical or legal scrutiny and not merit-based scrutiny, which would be particularly significant when we're talking about the making alternative provisions power, which is a policy change power. Under current practices, the impact of Parliament will be minimal, is my answer.
Okay, no, thank you for that. To Morag, Morag, you want to come in?
Yes, this is probably an appropriate point to make a couple of observations about the extent of the ability of Parliament to scrutinise anticipated secondary legislation made following this bill if it's enacted. I think there's a big picture question as well as a technical question. If I can take the big picture question first, which is associated with the volume of anticipated legislation. If, as Sir Jonathan's quite right to point out, that if it's not retained, it'll fall, and so there will be an obligation to retain if there is thought to be a danger that whole areas of life and work will be unregulated after the sunset provisions. So if there is a need, an obligation, a real premium placed on retaining things, then the volume of work that is likely to be required will impose a burden not just on those who are responsible for the preliminary stages, identifying the law in question and doing the necessary drafting, but also on those in Parliament who are required to scrutinise it. So that's the, if you like, the big picture question. That then breaks down, I'll turn to the technical point in a moment, but that then breaks down to perhaps distinguishing between where existing law is retained as is, if it's a simple measure that just says this is preserved and we don't want to make any modifications, then it can be anticipated that scrutiny of that might, it might be acceptable for that to be relatively light touch. After all, that's as it was, and no change is needed. However, if ministers are seeking to modify, to update, to develop, to make changes as appropriate, then that is exactly the sort of area that calls out for at least some measure of analysis. So it's important to distinguish between just a simple retention and retention with a bit of updating or something more than that. If I can turn then, and forgive me if this is something that we're going to come to anyway, I don't want to take you out of the order of your questions, but you were asking about the extent of Parliament to influence legislation as opposed to ministers. One of the interesting features of the bill itself is that it does distinguish in terms of procedure between what would happen in Westminster and indeed in the Senate in terms of the powers in Wales, where there is introduced, or there's proposed to be introduced in terms of Part 3, I think, of Schedule 3 to the bill, the ability to sift proposed legislation. And that simply means that there is an opportunity for Parliament to see proposals in draft. So measures that are going to be introduced will have to be laid in draft. I believe that the time period is 10 sitting days. That gives Parliament in Westminster, and I understand it in the Senate as well, the opportunity to say that this should not be done by negative procedure but by affirmative procedure. And that's referred to as the sifting power. Now, that doesn't exist in relation to measures that come before the Scottish Parliament. There's a memorandum from Cabinet Office to the Delegated Powers Committee in Westminster, which explains that I think the Scottish Government were content that that's not necessary. Now, I have to confess, I haven't dug into the reasons for that, and it's conceivable that the power exists elsewhere, perhaps in the 2010 Act. But it does seem to me that that's at least a distinction that ought to be of interest to this committee, and it may very well already be on your to-do list of things to look at. But it does... In answering your question about the extent of powers of Parliament, it probably is important to bear in mind that the powers of this Parliament in that respect, in that fairly narrow but important respect, are different to those that exist elsewhere. It is anticipated, I should say, that Northern Ireland doesn't have those powers either. And I think that was for practical reasons, that it wasn't possible to identify the need for them. But I understand that it's anticipated that it would be possible to introduce those at a later stage in the bill.
Good. Well, thank you. And Jonathan, do you want to come in on this at all?
Well, only very briefly. Just to stand back again, the unusual combination of the scope of this bill and therefore the range of a number of instruments that's likely to be made under it, inevitably they're going to, the capacity for parliamentary scrutiny will be limited. It will plainly be much less than would be the case if the government were to bring forward individual bills covering particular topics. So the fact that all this is being done by secondary legislation inevitably means that scrutiny will be limited, coupled with this fabulously quick timetable. I'm assuming that we stick to the 2023 deadline. That can be extended, as we know, in relation to individual instruments. But the existing deadline gives a year for all this to happen. And therefore, just it's a fact of practical life that the capacity for Parliament, again, I'm most familiar with the Westminster Parliament, but this, I think, must be true for the devolved parliaments, does the capacity for members of Parliament to scrutinise the volume of legislation that we can expect within the space of a year must inevitably be very limited, almost whatever procedure is used. So that's just to put it in that context.
So just to come on to kind of that particular point, but also points raised earlier. So we know that, irrespective as to what the figure is, we know it's in the thousands. in terms of piece of legislation. And the issue of capacity regarding the parliaments to scrutinise. But is the capacity there with officials to actually engage with each of these bits of law before obviously the decision is taken as to whether they should be extended or not? That's probably a question more for Sir Jonathan with your past.
Yes, thank you. Well, I wasn't official, of course, but I'm not anymore. So again, I don't have first-hand inside knowledge. I think this will be a huge challenge to the civil service. I mean, it might be said that they've had some time to prepare for this since we left. And obviously some work has been done to assess the range and the number of instruments that or laws that are affected, but we've also noted that that may be an uncertain number and it seems to be growing. So some preparatory work will no doubt have been done, and civil servants will do their best to go through the process we've described, which is to analyse these instruments and make proposals to ministers as to what should be kept and what should change. But in the scale of that will be hugely challenging. And the comparison I make is with the process that was gone through under the 2018 Act itself. So that's the statute that created the concept of retained EU law and conferred powers on ministers, again, quite wide powers, but they were powers to make relatively technical changes to retained EU law to cure deficiencies in the language of that Act in order that the law worked after we had left. And that was a big enough exercise. And I was in the civil service for at least part of that time and engaged every corner of Whitehall and certainly large parts of my department, the government legal department, in working through that body retained EU law, working out what technical changes, and they were mainly technical changes, were necessary to make the necessary, to make the laws work. And then many thousands of statutory instruments were produced do just that. And that took about 2 years. And it was a much more technical exercise, difficult though it was a much more technical exercise than what's being proposed now, where we have the potential of wide-ranging fundamental policy change to the very content of EU law. That's the whole point of this exercise. And a much shorter timescale, well, timescale of about half as long. So that's the comparison I make is with that earlier exercise. This is going to be shorter and much more difficult. And it's not just an issue for the civil service. It's not just about technical capacity to list the instruments and draft the legislation. The challenges to politicians, to ministers and parliamentarians to do a proper job to analyse the policy options and decide which laws should be changed and which not. And I would say ideally to consult with affected sectors. The bill contains no obligation to consult, and I don't know whether there will be meaningful consultation. So for all of those reasons, I think the system is going to be massively challenged, not just the technical civil service bit of it, but the whole political system. Because of, again, this combination of the scale of the bill and the very tight timescale.
Thank you for that. So I mean, you take me on to kind of the next area. You've just touched upon it there regarding consulting. So the issue of consulting and consent with Scottish ministers and the Scottish Parliament is something that's came up, I know, in the lead committee, but also it's come up in as a regular area of concern or frustration over quite some time between also from Scotland also to the UK Parliament. And obviously this particular bill has got the, well, it allows that the UK government, UK ministers, they could use the powers to preserve rule in devolved areas without the consent and consulting with Scottish ministers and the Scottish Parliament. In terms of the witnesses, do you have any comments about what that will actually mean in terms of dialogue and respecting the devolution. Dr. Tucker?
So the kind of constitutional version of that is that the Sewell Convention doesn't apply to delegated legislation. And what this bill does is it takes substantial policy areas which would otherwise need to be dealt with in primary legislation and therefore come under the protection of Sewell, and it affects a wholesale delegation of those policy areas into delegated legislation where the protection of the Sewell Convention doesn't apply. And so that does mean that there's a risk, a serious risk, that the integrity of the devolution settlements will come under pressure. It of course depends on practice under the Act, which is yet another of the issues that there's radical uncertainty about. But there's definitely a risk that because this removes a range of policy areas in their entirety from the protection of the Sewell Convention, that there will be an increase in the imposition of legislation on the devolved nations from the centre. But there's a lot of uncertainty about that.
Okay, thank you. So, Jonathan?
Very little to add other than the point I keep coming back to about the time constraints, which, even with a will, are going to prevent deep, meaningful consultation across the whole wide range of affected policy areas. I was earlier referring, and we may come back to this, I don't know, to the wider question of consultation, not just with devolved parliaments or administrations, but with, you know, with business, with affected sectors, and with society. And the bill contains no provision for that. And again, I don't know whether there will be scope for some of that to happen ad hoc. I hope so, but again, time is so limited.
Okay, thank you. And Morag.
I agree with the points just made. There are probably two categories of concern, and one is the simply pragmatic. That's not to downplay it. The points that have already been made, I think with some force by Sir Jonathan, just about the volume of work that's required, no matter where that falls, and I've already referred to the difficulties that can may arise in understanding piece by piece, instrument by instrument, what is within devolved and what's in reserve within devolved competence. Just that, having to carry out that exercise, even with, if everybody agreed that it should all happen, that's going to be challenging. So that's probably the primary challenge. But you're asking about challenges to do with absence of consultation or difficulties with consultation. And again, the primary issue is, when are you going to have time to do that? And I agree with the point already made that it's not just about politicians talking to each other or governments talking to each other. It's also understanding what interests there are out there in the world as to whether a particular set of regulations should be retained as they are or should be modified. On one view, taking a very pure view, it is a system which, given time, can be made to work. Questions about tension or about disagreements as to policy choices are essentially political issues, and those around this table will be well familiar with the challenges that those present. From a legal perspective, though, one of the consequences that may arise where there are divergent approaches on issues of policy in areas which do fall within devolved competence, if the ministers choose to take forward proposals or bring to the parliament legislation which will preserve, which will retain certain regulations whilst those are allowed to fall in England, say, and there are diverging means of regulating important areas that affect trade, business operations, then it's not too difficult to see that bumping into internal markets problems if these are likely to lead to unequal treatment in terms of regulation.
Thank you. And my final question at the moment is just regarding the negative procedure. It's been touched upon already. So regulations to preserve rule are subject to the negative procedure. Now, whether that's been made by the UK Parliament or in the Scottish Parliament, do you think that the negative procedure is actually appropriate for regulations which preserve rule? Morag?
Well, it depends. It's quite challenging to look at really important areas of regulation that have been carefully thought through historically, perhaps decades ago, perhaps recently at a European level, and then have been implemented whether in the United Kingdom or in Scotland, in the United Kingdom as a whole, or specifically in Scotland, with a great deal of care, to look at modification of those done at speed and say, yes, negative procedure will be just fine. That seems to be a little difficult. For some things where they can be put into the category of very purely technical, then one could look at things in a different way. It's probably more a matter for this committee than a strictly legal question. But I would, I don't want to repeat the point made earlier, that I think the bill does recognise that there perhaps ought to be scope for building in some protection, and I've referred already to the sifting provisions. Now, I'm not suggesting that that just cures all problems. I think there would be there would be those who would look at it and say, well, that's hardly good enough. It's just a brief opportunity to shift it into affirmative procedure. It might be thought that that at least having that protection brings some advantage. But I think combined with the time pressures, it's really hard to see this as being something that allows good quality scrutiny.
Okay, well, thank you. So, Jonathan?
Well, I think if your question is, if a regulation was purely retaining an existing piece of retained EU law without changing it, would the negative procedure be acceptable? And I think probably the answer to that is yes. And if the intention is not to change the law at all, but to keep it as it is, then that relatively light touch or very light touch form of scrutiny might be sufficient. I think we get into more difficulties where what's being proposed is a substantive change. But I think you have to look at the bill in the round, and the problem with it is all the ones we've talked about so far. So the combination of the powers with the cliff edge, so that if the powers aren't exercised, a piece of legislation will fall away automatically, just sort of rings alarm bells more generally. What one hopes is that lots of regulations retaining the existing law, it may just be that the volume of those is a problem in itself. But from the technical point of view, if you're asking, is negative enough if no change is being made, then probably the answer to that is yes. Whether that works in the context of the whole bill and the volume of legislation that might be forthcoming, I think is still potentially a problem.
Okay. Well, thank you. And Dr. Tucker.
Yeah, my views on that are very similar to Sir Jonathan's. So in general, I tend to be critical of the negative procedure in a lot of contexts. So that's the context of my answer. But your question was, I think I understood your question as being about regulations under this bill, which would be intended to revive the status quo. And I think even in principle, the answer to that is that yes, the negative procedure would be appropriate. But especially in context, when we think of the sheer volume of work that's going to be done, the answer is that the negative procedure is probably unavoidably the only scrutiny process that will work for regulations that revive the status quo under this bill.
Okay. No.
I understood the question. For pure retention as is, no change, I completely agree. I was thinking of the more of the modifying, amending, updating sorts of changes.
Okay. No, thank you very much for that. Bill Kidd.
Thank you, and thank you very much to our guest today. I think there's a wide range of areas which they're covering extremely well, because obviously much of this is uncertain or even unknown at the moment, as was said earlier. However, if you don't mind, a couple of quick questions really on the sunset date, a year's time from now. Now, the power to extend the sunset date is granted only to UK ministers, and we've got a quote here from the Scottish Constitution Secretary, Angus Robertson, who says that the Scottish Government has already requested that the extension power be conferred on devolved ministers, as we do not consider it appropriate that only UK ministers have the power to extend the sunset for devolved rule. So that's there's a bit of debate there, obviously, but so where UK ministers wish to extend the sunset date, including in devolved areas, there is neither consent nor consultation required at this point. This is obviously contentious. Does anyone have any points in particular on the sunset debate, sunset date, that they might wish to bring forward?
If clearly it is contentious for political reasons, I think there's one legal point that would arise if you had different powers to extend the sunset provisions, which, if those were to be exercised in at a high level, which is to say all regulations which fall within devolved competence, in respect of all of those, we're going to extend the sunset provisions, is that it leaves open the question of interpretation for what exactly is covered by those. If you are able, as Westminster can do, to say this is the sunset provision for absolutely everything, albeit it might be there might be things that get lost because they haven't been identified, then that's one thing. But if you're saying as a block we're going to extend the sunset provision, then you may be putting the burden of construing that on other people down the line. There may be some, it may just increase the uncertainty. I'm mentioning that as just anticipating a possible outcome of choosing to regulate in that way.
Thank you very much. Maura Gross, and possibly anything from Jonathan Jones or Jonathan?
Well, I don't really have anything to add on the specific political debate. But I think the idea of the sunset generally is a pretty appalling way to legislate, setting an artificial timescale that is so tight, with the risks we've described of either overloading the system or of laws just being missed and therefore falling away by accident, I think is a very poor way to legislate. If I could make one change to this bill, it would be to remove the sunset. But anyway, that's the more general point.
Thank you very much indeed for that. And Dr. Tucker, please.
No, I don't have anything to add to what the other two witnesses just said, because I agree with them.
Well, that's very useful. Thank you very much. I don't want to labour the point too much, actually, if there is a broad debate, but should the UK ministers wish to extend the sunset beyond the present date, they would need to specify individual pieces or categories of legislation to which the extension was to apply, because assuming that they would not just do it carte blanche in terms of an extension, would that mean that there are potentially different sunset dates for different legislation, which would be very complicated, I should imagine? Is anyone, Maura Gross, you got a point on that at all?
I think it potentially gives rise to the same sort of uncertainty. The complication that you're referring to would arise in a slightly different way, but that might be the result, is that you can, if you're going to distinguish between different blocks, different categories, trying to do that in advance in a way that gives people who need to know the clarity that they need is really challenging.
It would be. Yep, thank you indeed. And Sir Jonathan? Anything further?
Well, again, I just agree. But I agree with your analysis that the power to extend can only be exercised in relation to individual identified pieces of legislation. So there isn't the option of just saying the whole sunset date is postponed. It has to be done individually, and therefore that does definitely create the risk that you could have different dates for different bits of legislation or different sectors.
That's helpful, thank you. And Dr. Tucker, anything at all?
Yeah, so I have a mild disagreement with Sir Jonathan, but the thrust of my answer is going to be the same. The legislation as drafted plainly creates a situation where there may be multiple sunset dates for different legislation. And I would also suspect or speculate that that's actually a likely outcome rather than a mere possibility, because of the way that the extension power is structured. The sunset is very short, it's too short. So a sensible prediction would be, I think, that the extension power will be exercised in some fashion. And as soon as it's exercised, that's going to create a situation where there are different sunset dates for different regulations. Unless some way can be found to use the extension power to cover everything. Now, the power does allow specific legislation or this is my mild disagreement, a specified description of legislation. So it could be possible to try and use that power to describe all retained or assimilated by that point EU law. But the underlying problem is that it's clearly structured so as to allow different sunset dates. And I think that's a reasonably likely outcome because the initial sunset date is just so short that it must be extended in some fashion.
Thank you very much indeed. That's and opens up new areas of debate, no doubt, going forward. But that's very useful at the moment. And thank you to everyone for that. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Bill. Oliver.
Thank you, convener. I think we touched upon it already in relation to the appropriateness of the negative procedure, and I'll come back to that in a second. But I was interested when it comes to reinstating rule or assimilating law, the kind of power to use different words or concepts, but that doesn't go as far as making substantive changes to the policy effect of legislation. And it was to sort of understand, I think, Morag Ross, you mentioned sort of substantive change in one of your answers, but it's what the threshold for substantive change is, and kind of what the, you know, where you think that sits.
I think it's almost impossible to answer that in the abstract. It's not unknown to find that one word of difference in a section of an act makes a very substantive difference. Similarly, you can use an awful lot of words to say more or less exactly the same thing in different contexts, different legislative contexts. Clearly, there's a spectrum of modification. There might be, and this is, I can't provide concrete examples, but one can conceive of something which is totally uncontroversial updating. And that might be something that falls easily within the scope of something of easy to accept, uncontroversial, minor. But the bill anticipates not just the updating, the modest type of change, but also allows ministers power to modify in a more substantive way. I think that there are also references allowing ministers to take account of technological and scientific developments in a particular context. And that clearly anticipates that there will be substantive change of some kind. And that then leads to questions about the level of scrutiny that's demanded of those sorts of changes. I think the short point is, though, that it's not possible in advance to say this category of change is okay, this isn't, because it really does turn on what people are trying to do at a particular time and what words they're using.
If there's a disagreement on whether the change is substantive or not, what does that mean for the parliamentary process?
It presents a challenge. I appreciate that's not a very necessarily a very helpful way to look at it for you. Perhaps the concern, though, from out there in the world is that if there is disagreement or it's unclear as to what legislation means, whether changes, if substantive changes are made, but which haven't received adequate scrutiny and are untested, and that if those changes then cause uncertainty because people are unclear about the extent to which regulations apply to them, those are the more likely to be the more lasting consequences.
And if those sort of changes were subject to the negative procedure, you'd think that was, that you're saying quite clearly before that was too low a bar, I guess.
Well, I think I'd agree. I think the points that were made earlier by Sir Jonathan in distinguishing between the just preserving as is, mm-hmm. Retention of things as they are, and that negative procedure is likely to be fine. And I appreciate what you're asking me is whether, well, if it's just a minor change, is negative procedure okay? Well, yes, step up by step, but it doesn't take too long before what some people might say is a minor change, others would say, well, actually, that it, perhaps for reasons that are not anticipated, that introducing a new condition to a set of regulations, the view might be taken that that's relatively minor, but others would disagree. It's quite difficult, especially against the background of time pressure, to say, well, wait a minute, this should be taken out, given more extensive scrutiny, should be made subject to the affirmative procedure or whatever.
Okay. I didn't know if the other two witnesses had any sort of further comment on that sort of point.
I draw again the analogy with the exercise that was done under the 2018 Act to cure deficiencies in EU law, and I describe that as being a relatively technical exercise, so not making big policy changes, but just ensuring that the law worked. But in truth, some of those are more substantial than others, and therefore there was the sifting process for deciding what level of scrutiny those instruments should have. And really, rather underlining the point that's just made, even relatively technical changes can involve policy choices. So updating or technical adjustments, you have to make choices about, for example, how laws are going to be enforced, who enforces them, that kind of thing. Well, that can be important. So even something once may look like a relatively minor piece of updating can be significant. And that's before you get into the more substantial powers, for example, in Clause 15, positively, really, to make new law. And I agree, it's very difficult to say in the abstract without seeing exactly what changes are proposed.
Okay. No, thank you for that. I also wanted to ask, obviously the power to reinstate can be used to consolidate rule or assimilate law into a single instrument. What are the implications of that? Is that something you've got views on? And that, again, that's open to all three witnesses.
No, I don't have a view on that because of not because it's not an important question, but because of the uncertainty that swirls and the background of extremely high workload that these things will be done under. I don't have a view to put forward on the significance of that possibility. Sorry.
That's okay. Is there anyone else, or no one has a view? I'm happy to move on. Nope. The final question I wanted to ask was around regulations which reinstate rule or assimilated law, and they're subject to the negative procedure except where they amend primary legislation. in which case the draft affirmative is to be used. What's your view on the appropriateness of that procedure? Obviously, it's slightly different from some other parts of the bill.
I'm not sure that I've got anything to add to what you've already said about the distinction between straightforward retention and innovation.
Okay. And again, neither of the other two witnesses looking to speak.
So, Jonathan or Dr. Tucker?
No, I think it's the same problem, which is in the abstract working out, you know, what is a minor change. I mean, in principle, obviously, regulations that amend primary legislation, you might expect that they should get greater scrutiny, and the bill recognises that. But beyond that, I think it's very difficult to go beyond what we've said.
Thanks, Oliver. Paul.
Thank you, convener, and thanks to our panel for their helpful contributions this morning so far. I want to turn to the powers in Clause 15 in relation to allowing UK ministers and devolved ministers to revoke retained EU law up until the end of 2023 or assimilated law from the 1st of January 2024 and to replace it, and that power being available to ministers until the 23rd of June 2026. And where that provision is made to replace that retained or assimilated law, the replacement provision can implement different policy objectives. So I was just keen to get your collective views on the scope of this power to revoke and replace retained EU law and assimilated law. Maury Bros, if you wanted to start, perhaps.
Well, I think this does take the committee deep into policy territory, and there's a limit, I think, to what I can say about the political aspects of that. Clearly, it's in this part, in Clause 15, that one finds, I think, some of the most challenging provisions in the bill, so far as the extent to which ministers are enabled to innovate, to introduce policy changes of quite a substantial kind, using the powers that would normally exercise by introducing primary legislation, and for that to be tested in the normal way, this really is where you find the heart of the very broad powers to replace, to develop, to bring in new law. I mean, there's a great deal more that can be said about Clause 15 now, but I'm probably best to hand over to the other witnesses.
Dr. Tucker, do you have a comment to make on that, Dr. Tucker?
I do. I think that Section 15 is extremely constitutionally problematic. Because what it involves is a massive transfer of legislative power to the executive, which is always problematic in a sense because that downgrades the scrutiny that power receives. But this massive transfer is happening, and this exacerbates it, in circumstances where the scrutiny will be even less intense than normal because of the sheer volume of scrutiny that needs to be done. So there's one reason that Section 15 is constitutionally problematic, because it transfers legislative power to the executive at the same time as setting up a context where that won't be scrutinised even as well as normal. And the second way it's problematic is the devolution context, which I mentioned earlier, which is that one ramification of that transfer is to remove those policy areas from the protection of the Seal Convention. Which means that in devolved matters, those powers can be exercised without any consent from the devolved administrations. So those are the two reasons that I find Section 15 extremely problematic.
Thank you very much, Dr. Tucker. I think that's really helpful in terms of trying to understand the broader concerns politically. And so, Jonathan, do you have any further comments to make in relation to the broad scope of this section?
Well, only yet again to underline the fact. So these are broad powers, and this is the heart of the power in the bill to make new law, make new policy, as has been said. Just to reflect yet again that this covers. This is not limited by reference to particular areas of policy, as a bill normally would be. Even a bill with wide powers, you would normally have some kind of policy context, policy constraint. The only constraint here is that we're talking about retained EU law, but we all know that covers a vast range of topics, range of legal and policy areas. So that's another feature that's unusual about this power is the sheer breadth of policy and legal areas that it covers. And the government, as far as I'm aware, has given very little indication of what it intends to do with these powers. I don't think the explanatory notes to the bill gives examples of the kinds of laws or policy areas that it wishes to amend or adapt using these powers. And I've not seen anything else that does that. So these are broad powers in themselves, but the range of areas that they cover is, I think, unprecedentedly broad. And then you get into all the other issues that Dr. Tuck and others have talked about, which is the time scale and therefore the lack of scrutiny in the way that the exercise of the powers will be scrutinised.
Thank you very much for that. In terms of just verifying your position, would you regard that using secondary legislation for this purpose of revocation and replacement being completely inappropriate, and it should be primary legislation as an emphasis, or at least as a general presumption, rather than the emphasis being on secondary provision, just based on that need for scrutiny?
I don't want to cut across. I mean, again, it comes back to the spectrum, and Sir Jonathan is quite right to emphasise that within this spectrum, and mixing a couple of metaphors here, that within, at one end of the spectrum, the uncertainty, the unknown nature of what is involved is what presents the problem. It's the breadth combined with the unlimited nature, albeit it's in the context of retained EU law. At one end of the spectrum, at the modest level of replacement, of making minor changes, then it would be legitimate to say this is clearly something that's appropriate for secondary legislation. If it's something that would ordinarily require proper consultation, proper consideration, opportunities for scrutiny at primary legislation level, then it seems quite extraordinary if that's going to be done repeatedly, that should happen, even if it happens once, at a level where it's not receiving the same sort of scrutiny that it would if it were properly the subject of primary legislation. And I mean, one sees this problem in bits and pieces in some other acts. You find surprisingly broad powers, but they're normally confined to the subject matter of a particular bill or a particular act, and concerns are expressed about Henry VIII powers in a limited context. This is those sorts of powers, and then some, in this unconfined way, and it's the uncertainty at this stage of knowing what that looks like that's the problem.
Yeah, it seems like the power of determining that is entirely with the executive, and that therein lies the risk of democratic overreach. I just wanted to emphasise the UK government's position in terms of the Cabinet Office paper, where they say the power is required because there are approximately 2,000 pieces of secondary retained EU law, including retained direct EU law, and that the government may wish to replace with legislation more suited to the UK's needs, and to do so through purely sector-specific primary legislation would take a significant amount of parliamentary time. So their justification is there isn't enough capacity within the Parliament to handle that, but I assume you might agree that that is an overly generalised position, that there's probably more capacity to be a bit more nuanced with it all. Would you agree, Sir Jonathan?
Well, Well, I would. I mean, that is prioritising speed, really, as against quality of legislation. The assumption this needs to be done quickly and therefore it needs to be done in this way is a judgment the government has made that I personally wouldn't agree with. I mean, what you would normally expect is that the government, who wants to reform the law in any of these areas, which of course it's entitled to do, would bring forward a bill on employment law or a bill on product safety or environmental protection, and you'd have individual bills that would set out some policy parameters which Parliament could debate. And it might have powers within it, sure, but they'd have powers set in the context of a particular policy direction that Parliament would have the opportunity to consider. And that, of course, would take some time. And as we've said, it might involve some consultation with the relevant sectors and so on. And all of that takes time. But I would say good legislation does take time. And what the government has done with this bill is prioritise speed. They do it all in one big lump, do it within a year. Inevitably, yet again repeating it myself, that limits the opportunity for consultation or scrutiny. And it means that the powers that are within the bill are inevitably very wide and are not constrained in the ways that they would be in a normal bill that sets out a policy framework and all sorts of limitations and constraints on the powers which this bill doesn't contain.
Can I just bring in the response from the Cabinet Office in relation to this about the general powers? Because they say that retained EU law substance review has identified a distinct lack of subordinate legislation making powers to remove retained EU law from the UK statute book where appropriate, and if required, replace that provision with legislation that is more fit for purpose for the UK. Because it says that had the UK never been a member of the EU, many of the areas identified by the substance review would likely have already had similar powers comparable to non-EU policy areas to amend. So the lack of powers, therefore, being an oddity created by our EU membership. And that seems to be saying that the actual extraordinary situation is this retained EU law actually doesn't provide the same provisions in secondary legislation. Would you agree with that assessment, Sir Jonathan, or perhaps Dr. Tucker?
Well, let me come in quickly, as I may. Yeah. Well, you have to take the law as you find it, and Parliament, government and Parliament are entitled to change the law. And as I say, the way of doing that, I think, would be to bring forward specific policy-focused bills. And those bills could contain the powers that the government is now talking about, but the scope of those powers would be constrained by the overall policy, as I've said, and they would be debated by Parliament. They might have all sorts of other limits on what they could be used for. So if the government wanted to create that kind of power, it could do so. But I think what's objectionable about this bill is that it's seeking to do so all in one go for every area hitherto covered by EU law, and again, within the absurdly tight timescales that we've been talking about. So I think the answer to that is if the government wants powers, it should create powers, but it should do so in a thoughtful way, policy area by policy area.
Thanks for that.
Wants to come in.
Yeah, I was just to add a supplementary before you come in. Feel free to address all this, Dr. Tucker, but it was just also about if ministers were to choose not to bring forward replacement legislation, would there be any opportunity at all for Parliament to scrutinise that decision? But please do feel to give a general comment in relation to the discussion so far.
So the reason I asked to come in was to just mention another justification that the government has put forward for this power. So I agree with everything Sir Jonathan said about the time and capacity justification. The other justification that I've seen offered is the argument that because these matters were dealt with in secondary legislation then, that makes it appropriate to deal with them through secondary legislation now. But so that justification has been run alongside the time and capacity one. And I don't think that second justification is true either. The appropriate way to tackle these matters depends on the substance of what's being tackled and how it's being tackled, not on how it's been done in the past. And that possibility is wiped out by the wholesale nature of this bill. That's what I wanted to come in and and say that, that just because these things are in secondary legislation now doesn't entail that that's the appropriate way to deal with them in future.
Thanks for that, Dr. Stocker. Sorry, Mark.
I think that, I mean, I agree with what's been said. The Cabinet Office justification that you've referred to that rely, or at least starts with the question, had the UK never been a member of the EU, and this is really Dr. Tucker's point, that because it's been done in secondary legislation before now, implementing EU law, that it should be done in a particular way hereafter. I agree with Sir Jonathan, it doesn't matter how we got to where we are. We're looking at law from this point now, and we should be looking at the best way of ensuring that that law from this point onwards works. And in order to do that, Parliament and the Executive have to respect each other's powers and strengths, and it's important to scrutinise it in a proper way.
Thank you. I just wanted to probe again on my question about if the government were to not bring forward replacement legislation, that there would be, as I can see it, no capacity for the Parliament to influence that whatsoever, or have any form of scrutiny about the revocation of legislation. There might be a difference if they were to bring in replacement legislation, then a mechanism perhaps, but if they were just to simply revoke through secondary measures, there's no means to scrutinise whatsoever the impacts. Dr. Tucker, have you got a view? Sir Jonathan, sorry.
The effect of the sunset clause is that if ministers do nothing, I mean, including if they consciously decide to do nothing, then a given piece of EU law will fall away. And yes, it's right, none of the parliaments will have any opportunity to influence that decision once this bill is passed, because the sunset will be the sunset. And ministers then, either by accidentally doing nothing, or, as I say, by deliberately deciding, no, actually, we're happy for this particular piece of legislation to expire, then Parliament will have no opportunity to scrutinise that at all. That will be the automatic effect of the bill.
Well, that's quite an alarming sort of realisation that potentially could have wholesale destruction of legislation in that way, but
the foundation
without any capacity for Parliament. Yeah, so I think just making it as stark as that was quite a powerful comment. I think also just looking at the issue around ministers will not be able to use the revocation replacement powers to increase regulatory burdens, and I think the Hansard Society has stated in that regard that it, you know, just with a few caveats, is a do anything we want power for ministers, and that clause 15 brackets 5 of the bill imposes what amounts to a regulatory ceiling. This might be contrary to previous claims from UK ministers that in some areas have retained EU law that might be amended to enhance regulatory requirements, for example, in the field of animal welfare. So in your view, Sir Jonathan, to start with, will this preclude ministers from improving standards, rights and protections which are currently enshrined in retained EU law?
Well, again, sorry to just say, I think it's very difficult to answer in the abstract, because the power, the overall effect of the power, which is subject to some constraints, including the constraint about not increasing regulatory burdens, but I think without having the text just at hand, there's an assessment of what the overall effect power is, and within that there could be, you know, changes to one aspect of a provision that tighten it up. And at the same time, other aspects might be loosened, and the minister might conclude that the overall effect is not to increase regulatory burdens. So it's quite a subtle provision in that way. And again, without looking at a specific example, it's difficult to say whether it would be within the overall power or not. So the overall intention, I suppose, is intended to be reassuring that this is not intended to increase regulatory burdens, that one person's regulatory burden is another person's protection. So if by that it's meant that we can't increase protections, then that's a political constraint on the power. But what that adds up to in practice, one can, you know, it's difficult to predict until you see a particular use of the power.
Okay. I appreciate that. Thank you, Sir Jonathan. Dr. Tucker, have you got a view on this kind of ratcheting effect that it can only move in one direction in terms of using the secondary powers for enhancements which aren't available?
So I think that limit on the power gives it a clear deregulatory bias. That's our starting point, that this is a power that doesn't have many limits on it, but one of the explicit limits on it is that it is a deregulatory power rather than an increasing regulatory power. But like Sir Jonathan said, what counts as increasing a regulatory burden is hard to understand, especially in the abstract. And there's two issues, neither of which I can say anything on other than drawing attention to them. And the first one is that I think your question was actually about the conformity of that subsection, that subclause, with previous government promises, wasn't it?
Yes.
So I think it probably does contradict previous promises to use this mechanism for increasing regulatory protections in some circumstances. But it's also an issue outside previous promises about how this power will be used, because it sets the boundaries for how it can be used, even if that hasn't been promised in the past. So it goes beyond the fact that it's a breach of a previous representation of what the act would, of what the bill would look like, doesn't it?
Thanks for that, Dr. Tucker. Morag Ross?
I'm not sure I have a particular additional point to make. If you were expecting to see very significant thoroughgoing regulatory change, then you would expect that to be brought forward in primary legislation anyway. I think that the limits that are placed around increasing burdens are it's really quite difficult to offer meaningful analysis of that without seeing what it actually looks like in substance.
Okay, that's fair enough. Thanks very much. I think, Chair, that's my...
Thank you. Now I'm going to bring Bill in. I know Bill's got a question about Clause 16.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, everyone. Just to take this on just very slightly further, Clause 16 was described as by the Hansard Society as the power to update being very open-ended. And they were questioning even whether a change in technologies or development scientific understanding has occurred, for example, with respect to artificial intelligence, genetically modified organisms, or net zero, whether that power should be within the scope of ministers to update rule in these areas and assimilated law to take account of changes in technology or developments in scientific understanding, which obviously these days we see large movements in. Would you think that it is reasonable for ministers to be left with that ministerial discretion in these instances, please? Morag, please.
Again, I think this is possibly just an example of really quite broad drafting that could cover at the entirely mundane level something relatively straightforward. And the sorts of examples that you've mentioned, it's possible to think of those as introducing something rather more significant. There is a breadth built into this. All will depend on how that's exercised. I'm sorry, that's probably an unilluminating question, but or answer rather to your question. But again, what we see here is a broad scope. Show us the detail, and then we can understand what that actually looks like.
Sure. Thank you very much. And Sir Jonathan, anything to add there at all?
No, really, it's the same point. Just a very broad power, spanning a huge range of existing law, and no certainty about how it will be exercised. It could be for minor things, it could be for much bigger ones.
Well, thank you for that. And Dr. Tucker, anything?
No, nothing to add, but the reason I have nothing to add is because of the uncertainty.
Aye. Well, thank you very much indeed to everyone for making a brave attempt at that one. Thank you.
Thank you. I think Paul, you had another question.
To come back on the point on clause 8 around legislative hierarchy, relating to the removal of the principle of supremacy of EU law, well, clause 4 of the bill reverses the principle that retained EU law takes precedence over incompatible domestic law. The power in clause 8 enables ministers to specify that the reversal of the principle does not apply to specific pieces of domestic law and retained EU law, and therefore retained EU law continues to take precedence. So this allows ministers to retain the existing hierarchy where this is desirable to avoid unintended consequences or to ensure continuity. So I just wanted to ask if the power in clause 8 is exercisable by both Scottish ministers and UK ministers in areas of devolved competence. UK ministers are therefore given power to set the interpretative hierarchy that applies to legislation in devolved areas, and bearing in mind that the devolution settlement was never designed with the presumption that we'd end up outside of the EU. So it has kind of caused that disruption. Do you have any comments to offer on that? I wonder if we start with Dr. Tucker, perhaps.
So I doubt the UK government will be enthusiastic about using this power, even though they're giving it to themselves. The background, in fact, it's the background to a lot of this bill, is that this bill undoes some of the things that were done in previous legislation, in the UWA in particular. And I think this is a clause which is intended to be a safety net where there's interaction between different enactments, domestic enactments and enactments made under this bill. And so on the one hand, it's eye-catching because it's about supremacy and changing hierarchies. But on the other hand, the effect of using or exercising the power under this clause would only be to maintain the status quo before this bill was enacted. Because the EUWA maintains the supremacy principle, this is a clause which is designed to let ministers maintain that status quo rather than have the reversal that would happen as the default position under the new bill. So it's eye-catching, but it's about the status quo.
That's helpful. Thank you very much, Dr. Tucker. So, Jonathan, do you have anything further to add?
Well, I feel I'm becoming very repetitive, but I think that, the real problem with this combination of provisions is the uncertainty that they create, because the abolition of supremacy is being done in the abstract. So you have an existing set of rules about interpretation, which were preserved by the EU Withdrawal Act, because the whole aim of that act was, as far as possible, to secure continuity and certainty in the law. So you don't arbitrarily change how the law is going to be interpreted. You keep the same rules, and that included the rule of supremacy, which is politically anathema to some, including apparently the government. So they changed the rule to take away the doctrine of supremacy, but again, without any real indication of what that might mean in practice for particular areas of law. And that creates uncertainty, because you change the way the law is to be interpreted deliberately. It's open to people to argue that settled interpretations from the past should now be changed, previous court decisions should be reopened, and so on. We've no idea what will happen as a result of any of that. So that's the big uncertainty point. Then the government takes power in the bill that says, well, in case we don't like the results of that provision, we will reverse it to restore the pre-existing provision. And you think, well, that's okay, but we've no idea yet again whether the government will in fact do that. And Dr. Tucker may be right. The government may be very loath to do that, because the headline is to get rid of the doctrine of supremacy. So the end result is that we simply don't know what the effect will be in any particular areas of law. It may take litigation. It may be in the interests of certainly big corporate entities to seek to relitigate some of these issues. And it may take litigation to work out whether, and if so, how the law has changed as a result of this reversal of the hierarchy. And then on top of that, we've got this question, well, will the government exercise this power to restore the status quo? And we just don't know.
Okay, Morag Ross, have you any points?
I don't have anything to add. The critical thing is this is unclear. It opens up possibilities. How that will be implemented, I think, just don't know.
Okay. Well, that's certainly helpful. It's more questions than answers, I suppose, it begs. But I guess that's just a sign of the kind of constitutional immaturity of a lot of this and how the government's proceeding. But thanks very much. Okay.
Thank you, Paul. Can I just come back to Sir Jonathan, that you mentioned the word litigation there. I think Paul's question was in Clause 8, but just as a whole with the bill. And I think also the word uncertainty has been used quite a lot this morning from witnesses in terms of what may or may not happen going forward. But on the issue of litigation, is that something that the witnesses would actually expect to take place because of that lack of clarity by way of the number of regulations and the numbers of pieces of legislation that actually will be covered by this bill? Because obviously, whether it's the 2,400 plus the 1,400 or 5,000 or whatever. Because that was, I dare say there'll be some organisations at some point in the future will operate and take decisions based upon what they think is the law, but potentially will actually have been covered by what's about, what may happen with this law, and potentially if there's, with the sunsetting, then the initial law might not actually exist anymore because it's obviously fallen off the statute book. So do you expect an increase in litigation to actually happen overall as a consequence of this piece of legislation from the UK government? Morag.
I think there are at least two different categories of situation that might arise. I think taking from your question, the first category would be the circumstances where a group of people who had understood that they were being subject to a particular set of regulation now no longer are, and that's to their disadvantage. And that's happened perhaps by accident, perhaps things have run out of time, perhaps something has fallen off the cliff edge that ought to have been caught and it's tumbling down and that's causing a problem. I can't rule out that somebody would want to raise proceedings following that, but it would seem to me that if there's a general acceptance that something has been missed that ought not to have been, and it's in the accidental category almost, then the way to deal with that is potentially by emergency legislation in order to plug a gap if that arises. It would be hard to see what taking that through the courts would add. You might be looking for some emergency measure such as a declarator if it were being raised in the courts here, conceivably, but that instinctively that seems rather unlikely. More difficult, I think, to call is a different set of circumstances where there is a point of view taken by people whose interests are adversely affected by a change in a regulatory position, for example, who disagree with what's been done, who disagree with the way in which it's been done and perceive that their interests have been unlawfully affected. Again, really difficult to say in the abstract what that might look like, where they might raise proceedings, on what grounds. It can't be ruled out, but I think it's probably important to distinguish between those two categories, and no doubt there are other categories as well.
Before I bring in the other panellists, I think just on the point regarding your first category, certainly to bring in emergency legislation, I think obviously it could be quite time consuming as well to also pull something together. But I think on the issue of capacity, which was raised earlier, I know I'd asked the question to Sir Jonathan, does the civil service actually have the capacity to look at all the legislation that's currently there? Because I think Dr. Tucker had indicated that Certainly officials would have to engage with all the legislation that's there. Now, with the short time that we do have, there is a possibility that not every piece of legislation will actually be engaged with to take an active decision on before a sunsetting does or doesn't happen on that particular piece of legislation. Excuse me. So I think I would suggest that with the capacity issue, with the short timescale that's there, notwithstanding obviously the potential to extend for sunsetting, the issue of litigation could be a it could potentially be a regular occurrence if businesses or trade sectors end up being caught in something that actually wasn't fully considered beforehand.
Just to come back on, if it's a choice between uncontroversial emergency legislation, which might be as simple as saying we meant to retain this in its entirety, we didn't actually want to modify it or amend it in any way, we just wanted to preserve it and it got missed, that's likely to be something that could be done pretty swiftly, especially if it's uncontroversial, that is likely to be the more efficient way of solving that particular problem. Again, quite difficult in the abstract. Repeated litigation carries its own uncertainties. It is, nobody goes to court, or very, very few people go to court on advice that they are bound to succeed. It's not something that even big corporations embark on lightly, and in areas of policy uncertainty where there are likely to be political pressures as well, it's a fairly significant undertaking. All that I can say at this stage is that it might be something that people with interests in these areas will be contemplating. Will there be a slew of cases? Don't know. But as I say, uncertainty is often something that puts people off taking that route too.
Yeah, well, thank you. So Jonathan and Dr. Tucker.
Well, I think there is a significant risk of litigation. We go back yet again to this point about certainty. Businesses, including the clients of my firm, Linklaters, like a tolerable level of legal certainty, where they've ordered their affairs on the basis of the existing law. And the purpose of the Withdrawal Act, as I've said, was as far as possible to preserve that law with as much certainty and continuity as possible. And I think, broadly speaking, that succeeded. So there wasn't actually much litigation immediately following our withdrawal, because the law continued more or less as before. Now what's happening, though, is a huge disruption to legal certainty in all the ways we've described. First of all, because we simply don't know what's going to happen under this bill and therefore what the law will actually be by the end of 2023. That's very disruptive for business. And many business groups have said this, so I don't need to say it for them, that this uncertainty as to what the law will be makes it very difficult for businesses. I'm thinking of businesses, but the same applies to all sorts of other organisations, every user of the law, who needs to order their affairs in such a way as to comply with the law and undertake their dealings with their counterparties in accordance with the law, that all of that is thrown into doubt. Of course, the law can change at any time. Business is used to the law changing, but not in this way, not across this huge spectrum of area, not all by secondary legislation, and not within the space of a year. So the risk that the law now gets changed in ways that are unclear, and certainly that disadvantage particular interests, or to go back to the point about the hierarchies, this is not just about the use of the power, but what the bill says itself about the abolition of doctrine of sovereignty, of supremacy, for example, that changes the meaning of the law in some way, that it's in the interest of a business to litigate I think that must be a significant risk. So this disruption of certainty, this disruption of business, might very well prompt disputes, and always would go to litigation. Obviously, clients try and avoid litigation where possible, but there must be a risk that that will happen, I would think.
Thank you. And Dr. Tucker.
Thank you. I absolutely defer to the other two witnesses on the question of the practical likelihood of litigation. But I will just reinforce something that Sir Jonathan said about the reason that I worry about uncertainty, and I suspect it's a similar reason that the two worry about uncertainty, and that's to do with the rule of law and the ability to make plans and to plan one's affairs and to plan one's life. When there's radical uncertainty, it's not possible to plan your affairs. And so the two reactions are to not make decisions or to make decisions which turn out to be wrong as the law changes. And so that's the problem with radical legal uncertainty, is it destabilizes the lives of individuals, of organizations, of businesses, of public authorities, because they don't know the outcome of the decisions before them, so they can't plan their affairs. The theoretical side, which I'm familiar with, says that one consequence of that is litigation, but I'll defer to the other two witnesses on the practical likelihood of that in this case.
Thank you. And kind of one final area of questioning, it's on the issue of Henry VIII powers, which any time Henry VIII powers are spoken about, they tend to be, they bring some controversy along with them. So prior to the publication of the bill, the public law project and written evidence to the House of Commons European Scrutiny Committee inquiry into retained EU law, into their retained EU law inquiry, stated that, and I quote, broad Henry VIII powers for the UK executive to make law in any area of former EU competence would be constitutionally inappropriate. And in the Scottish Parliament, our Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee, in their recent report entitled The Impact of Brexit on Devolution, they stated, and I quote, the committee's view is that the extent of UK ministers' new delegated powers in devolved areas amounts to a significant constitutional change. We have considerable concerns this has happened and has continued to happen on an ad hoc and iterative basis, without any overarching consideration of the impact on how devolution works. In terms of the panellists, do you have any comment about the Henry VIII nature of many of the powers contained in the bill? Dr. Tucker?
So the Henry VIII powers are always slightly problematic because of the way they disturb our kind of settled understanding of the hierarchy of different institutions who can legislate. I think there's an attempt made in this bill to manage that risk, isn't there? In that the main Henry VIII powers, the main way that the powers in this bill extend to be Henry VIII powers, are that they're restricted, if I understand the bill correctly, to making changes to primary legislation where the provisions in that primary legislation were originally put there by the previous exercise of a Henry VIII power. So there's a strange constraint over many of the powers in this bill. But I do worry that repeats the error that I mentioned earlier, that it invites us to judge what the appropriate way to do something now is by looking how it was done in the past. So if that thing's been done by secondary legislation in the past, it's appropriate to do it in that way now. And this is an extension of that idea, isn't it? That if a thing is primary legislation, but it was inserted into that primary legislation by secondary legislation, it's okay to go right back to the start of the process and revisit the original secondary legislation. I think that kind of perpetuates the error of doing things now how they were done previously, where the focus should be on the substance of the policy area concerned and the nature of the change being made.
Thank you. And Sir Jonathan?
Well, I agree with that particular point, that the origin of the provision ought not now to be the test. The test should be what's the substance of the change now being made. But I tend to try and avoid using words like unconstitutional, because in the end, if Parliament passes this bill, Parliament can pass it, and if it passes it, these powers will be the powers that they are, and that's the way our constitution works. But they are undoubtedly very wide powers, and against the combination of the factors in this bill. So Henry VIII's powers are by definition very wide. These are the widest of all, because they include power to amend the bill itself. So they are very wide, undoubtedly, but they apply across the huge range that this bill itself covers, as I keep saying. So that, to me, put it this way, rings alarm bells over the scope of the power. And then we come back to what's the scope, either in principle or in practice, for Parliament, any of the parliaments, to scrutinise the exercise of those powers. And that is, for all the reasons we've said, very limited. So taking all those things in combination, that without avoiding it unconstitutional, I think it's a bad way to legislate.
Okay, no, thank you. And Morag.
I don't have anything to add to that. I think we've discussed and identified the issues that arise when powers are of this breadth and this scope.
Okay, no, thank you. Do colleagues have any further questions?
No, thank you very much.
Okay. Panelists, do you have anything else you'd like to put on the record today that you haven't already highlighted? Morag?
No, thank you. I'd like just to reiterate my thanks for the invitation to faculty and to me. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. So, Jonathan?
No, same thing. Thank you. I think we've got a lot of ground. Thank you for asking me.
No problem. Thank you. And Dr. Tucker?
Exactly the same answer. Nothing to add, but thanks for inviting me and listening to me today.
Yeah, no problem. Thank you. I'd like to thank Sir Jonathan Jones, Dr. Adam Tucker and Morag Ross Casey for their extremely helpful evidence this morning. The committee may follow up by letter with any additional questions stemming from the meeting. So with that, once again, thank you very much. And I'll briefly suspend the meeting to allow Morag Ross to leave the room and for witnesses to leave blue jeans. Thank you.